So this is the first episode of our new disruption report, where we will basically explore different disruptive technologies in more depth. And don't worry, we certainly won't only cover space topics, but also electric cars, air taxis, hyperloop, boring tunnels, life extension, transhumanism, and stuff like that. Our regular disruption report ended up being too Tesla focused all the time, and people weren't really interested in our Wednesday video so much anyways, as not even half of our subscribers watched those videos. As for today's episode, you, dear viewers, have watched it from what SpaceX and Elon Musk will do after the first Mars colony has been established. So let's do a good old thought experiment and try to figure out how the future of SpaceX might look like after the primary goal of settling on Mars has been achieved. And we should be crystal clear and honest that this is a thought experiment, because we are pretty sure that not even Elon himself or Gwynne Shotwell know exactly what they will do once the Mars colony has been established. Okay, now that this is out of the way, let's travel forward to the year 2050.
The Mars colony at Erebus Montes is up and running. Self-sufficiency has been established. A fleet of 1,000 Starships is regularly traveling every 26 months between Earth and Mars, when they align, bringing thousands upon thousands of new settlers to Mars every launch window. The Mars space has now grown into a city with around 100,000 inhabitants and is expanding more and more. First, small other bases are being established on other parts of Mars, and the work on an underground hyperloop network to connect Mars City Alpha with the smaller settlements has also begun. Humans have already begun to adapt to this new living environment, and thanks to the power of genetic engineering, a new breed of humans is being born and raised on Mars. Humans especially adapted to be living in a low gravity environment, with increased bone and muscle mass to counter the adverse effects of low gravity. Humans that can withstand higher amounts of lifetime radiation exposure. Then work on a Mars space elevator for cheaper and easier access to space might have begun, because building such a space elevator on Mars is much easier than on Earth, due to the lower gravity field of Mars with only 0.38 g on the surface.
Also, an independent Mars government has long been formed. As already detailed in the Starlink beta user agreement, Mars has a government independent from Earth, and is a direct democracy, where every citizen can elect council members of the Mars Government Council via the blockchain. Every citizen has the link, as it will be called, a very much advanced form of the current Neuralink brain-machine interface, allowing the Mars citizens to download and upload vast amounts of information and access the Mars datasphere. Voting that way will become very simple and extremely direct, and being based on the decentralized blockchain technology, also fail-safe and safe against manipulation, as the whole voting process is visible in the decentralized blockchain voting ledger. The council members will have to meet quite some criteria to be eligible for the council: above average analytical and emotional intelligence, a very thorough scientific education, and profound knowledge in at least one field of science. So basically exactly the opposite of current day politicians. This governing body will be aided by an AI advisory counselor, a holographic projection of the AI hive mind network, in which the central AI will be connected to all citizens via the link. A Starlink satellite network will ensure global Martian communications access, even in remote areas, such as the new outposts on the caldera of Olympus Mons, in the deep valleys of Noctis Labyrinthus, in western Valles Marineris, and in the deep plains of the Hellas Basin. And please consider subscribing to our channel, because as a subscriber, you can always vote for the topics of our new disruption report, or even make your own topic suggestions. So together, we can explore many more disruptive technologies. We really appreciate your support.
Communications with Earth and the cities of the Moon will be established via the Starlink interplanetary network, which will work with beamed high-energy pulsed laser transmission. Unfortunately, by 2050, there most likely still won't be a way for faster-than-light communication. Thus, there still will be a delay between Earth and Mars, ranging from 3.5 minutes to 22 minutes, depending on Earth's and Mars' relative position to one another in the solar system. But I have to disappoint you, despite our title, which was meant more like a joke, Elon probably will not become president of Mars. He will be a very respected senior member of the government council, but his word will not have more weight than those of the other members, who also show extraordinary abilities. The colonies on the Moon will also thrive and grow. Since the Moon is much nearer to Earth than Mars, resupplying and building cities on the Moon will have been much faster than on Mars. And by 2050, 500,000 people will be living on the Moon already, since a fleet of lunar starships will be constantly flying between Earth and the Moon, constantly bringing new settlers to the Moon. And now the time will have come where Elon, having been genetically modified with the latest life extension technology to live at least another 50 years, will think of what to do next. He will meet Quinn Shotwell, who will be of course also genetically modified, and they will ponder on the next steps where Starship could establish a human presence. After long conversations, they will decide to establish a first base on Ceres, because it is the gateway to the outer solar system, and Ceres even has a subsurface ocean of water. The asteroid belt also has lots of valuable asteroids, so SpaceX will start to enter the asteroid mining business. 16 Psyche will be one of the first targets, and SpaceX will establish the first real deep space mining infrastructure, quite similar to the way how Tesla is doing it nowadays by entering the lithium and nickel mining business. Once Ceres base is established, it will of course also act as a refueling depot to power larger Starship 2.0s, which will travel towards the outer solar system. Once Ceres base is established, it will of course also act as a refueling depot to power larger Starship 2.0s, which will travel towards the outer solar system. Elon and Gwyn might decide that a base on Callisto will make most sense, as this moon is quite far away from Jupiter's radiation belts. Thus, the radiation on the surface will be acceptable as compared to, for example, Europa. From Callisto, missions to study the subsurface oceans of Europa will be launched.
Also, larger starships will be built directly on site, using new and advanced in-situ resource utilization techniques and nanotechnology advancements. These larger starships will fly to Saturn and build colonies on Titan and Enceladus. Titan will be the perfect refueling base, as it contains gigantic lakes of liquid methane and ethane. But we sincerely hope that by that time, starships will not be powered by such propellant anymore for long-distance travel, but by nuclear thermal propulsion, or better yet, by some form of Hall-effect thrusters or magnetoplasma thrusters. Cloud cities on Venus might be established during that time, since the technology to build floating cities will be deemed safe enough for large-scale use. Bases at Uranus, Neptune, and even Pluto might be established by the later half of the 21st century. Now the year is 2100. Elon and Gwyn, even with life extension technology, will be among the oldest humans in the history of humanity. They will be too old to receive the latest round of life extension technology, which only works on younger humans, allowing them to live indefinitely. They will thus decide to mind upload their entire knowledge and personalities into the Martian AI neural net and become part of the AI. Elon and Gwyn's replica personalities will continue to act as holographic AI advisors, having the utmost respect from the Martian government council. But now, with the entire solar system colonized, what next? Of course, the terraforming of Mars will be the first on the agenda of the next huge undertakings, and work on that mega project will start by then. But the joint Earth and Mars government will also start collaborating on the first interstellar missions. The first interstellar probes will have already reached neighboring star systems decades earlier. For example, the Breakthrough Starshot project will have already sent the first high-resolution pictures of the planets of the Proxima Centauri system by the year 2060.
But of course, the ever-expanding human race wants to explore the deeper depths of the universe. And the time will have arrived for humanity to leave behind the cradle of the solar system for the first time. Huge interstellar generational ships will be built by SpaceX. SpaceX will amass the brightest talents from all colonies of the solar system, where giant O'Neill cylinders will be built in Mars orbit, which will be powered by huge fusion reactors. In a nod to the early Starship names, these cylinders will be called BFCs. Many habitable exoplanets which can support life will have been discovered by then. In a radius of only 100 light years, 86 Earth-like exoplanets will have been discovered by that time with an Earth similarity index of 0.9 and higher. And out of those, 17 will have been found to be superhabitable, meaning that they offer even better conditions for life than Earth itself. The nearest such planet, which will be called Enigma in our fictional story, will be found to circle a K-type dwarf star 36 light years away. These generational huge rotating cylinder ships will reach 30% the speed of light after a very, very long period of acceleration. An equally long period of deceleration will of course be needed to slow down the BFCs before they reach their respective destinations.
The humans, or more precise, post-humans, traveling on those giant spaceships will not really think of them as ships, but more as mobile planets for all intents and purposes. They will have landscapes on the inside, rivers and parks with lots of green, and larger and smaller settlements. They will be like small traveling planets. After 150 years, the first ships will have reached Enigma and built the first colony of humanity in another star system. Since communicating with Earth takes many decades, this colony will effectively start a new humanity on a distant planet, the new seed of a species which will evolve differently from humanity, and thousands of years later will differ quite a lot in appearance from the ancient humans of our days. More and more BFCs will reach other habitable planets. New life forms will have been discovered, many new plant forms. These new humanities will peacefully coexist with the native flora and fauna, as only planets will have been chosen that do not host intelligent life. By that time, contact with at least one other intelligent civilization will have been established. As the centuries pass, more intelligent civilizations will be discovered. And in the year 3000, humanity will live on many different planets across 27 star systems and belong to a club of species that are in contact with one another. And then at some point, warp drives will be built.
The descendants of SpaceX will start to build faster than light ships, being able to travel to faraway star systems much faster than ever before, allowing humanity to meet and trade with other intelligent species. The many humanities, which have grown apart over the last 1,000 years, will start growing together and form one humanity again after all this time. And SpaceX will still exist, because it will be remembered that SpaceX has enabled all this, and that this exciting future for humanity would not have been possible without people like Elon Musk or Gwynn Shotwell, and the many amazing and talented people working for SpaceX in the early 21st century. And if you're wondering how terraforming Mars might actually work, which is something that certainly will be done at some point in the far future, we did a video about it, which you can watch right here.
So thanks for watching this new episode of the JS Disruption Report. And I would say, on to the future.
Good, too long?
So, for me it's too long, but you added it so you can decide if it's really too long.
I will try to do it a bit shorter.
It sounds like a bark.